No, it's great. And this seminar is a great model as well of various formats that history and policy, the National Project, has been experimenting with, where we get historians in dialogue with contemporary policymakers and practitioners. So today we've got Laura Schwartz from Warwick, who's going to be talking to us about domestic servants' unions in early 20th century Britain. And Laura is an associate professor in modern British history at Warwick, and she's published very widely on the history of feminism and the history of higher education. And she's currently writing a monograph which is called Feminism and the Servant Problem, Class Conflict and Domestic Labour in the British Women's Suffrage Movement. She's a member of Warwick UCU, and she's also active in the London group Feminist Fight Back. And our respondent today is Karol Florek, who has a background of working with unions in Australia, where he worked with United Voice, the Australian trade union, on unionising in the care sector. He moved to the United Kingdom in 2014, and since then he's been working for UniGlobal, the union network based in Brussels and Geneva, and also with the European Economic and Social Committee, and he'll talk a little bit more about his work. So welcome to both Laura and Karol, and over to Laura for her paper.
Okay, hello everybody. Thank you for inviting me here today. When Karl Marx was developing his theory of proletarian revolution, declaring the working class to be agents of their own history, and insisting that only they, rather than well-meaning middle-class reformers, could transform the conditions under which they laboured, he explicitly excluded domestic servants from his definition of the proletariat. For Marx, servants were nothing more than baubles of luxury, flunkies and lickspittles, he called them, and they were therefore of, quote, microscopic significance to the class struggle. The fact that servants were by far the most numerous kind of worker, both in the 1860s when Capital was written and well into the 20th century, did not concern him, because Marx argued that servants did not generate surplus value. Whereas an industrial worker produced commodities whose value could be circulated for profit, a servant's labour produced only use value, a personal service for their employer that would be consumed and therefore its value entirely dissipated in that single exchange. Marx's understanding of labour power as an abstract entity, a potential capacity to labour that does not realise its value until it becomes congealed into a commodity, wed him to an understanding of productive labour as only that which produced, quote, vendable things or objects. At times, therefore, Marx extended his dismissal of servants to all workers who produced services rather than commodities, from the bootblack up to the king, he wrote, including many of the professions, none of whom he believed could be mobilised as a revolutionary force in the manner of the industrial proletariat. Many Marxists, socialists, and labour movement activists in the 19th and early 20th century shared Karl Marx's lack of interest in organising domestic servants. Although the servant problem was widely commented upon as a problem of low wages and terrible conditions, few looked to servants themselves as the people who might be able to do something about this. Labour historians have often followed suit, and until very recently, domestic servants seldom appeared in histories of class struggle or the making of the English, or indeed any other, working class. The invisibility of servants' labour to all these groups of labour movement activists was compounded, or perhaps even provoked, by the fact that, of course, across Europe, the vast majority of servants were women, labouring in the private sphere of the home. So my research focuses on the domestic servants who defied such expectations, and in the early 20th century began to form themselves into unions, to demand that their labour was recognised as real work, that the relationship between mistress and maid was not a personal matter, but a cold, hard employment contract, and that housework could be legislated for and regulated just like any other form of work. Okay, so of course one of the main reasons that I've been able to uncover a history of domestic worker organising in Britain that had been passed over by preceding generations of historians is because I've been able to learn from the last 40 years of feminist and post-colonial scholarship offering heterodox readings and reconfigurations of Marx's definition of the proletariat. This scholarship has expanded Marx's focus on white male factory workers to include, among others, reproductive labourers, whether waged or unwaged, inside or outside the home. And in particular, I owe a debt to the Marxist feminists of the 1970s who theorised work that reproduces people rather than things and insisted that capitalism depends upon reproductive labour. Such scholarship developed in parallel and was inspired by the re-emergence of domestic worker organising, especially in Latin America, South Africa and India in the late 20th century, and brought to the United States and Western Europe by migrant workers from the Global South in the early 21st century. So perhaps we can talk about this afterwards, but in turn, I'm interested in how a history of domestic servants' unions can be helpful in illuminating some of the present challenges we face as class struggle activists in post-industrial economies, where most people work in the service sector rather than in manufacturing. The last 10 years or so has witnessed the emergence of a new and thriving historiography on domestic service in Britain. Yet, as historian Selina Todd has pointed out, an emphasis on the personalised master-servant relationship has tended to neglect the importance of pay and conditions in shaping social relations between servants and employers. So in following this call to kind of reinsert domestic service into a history of modern class relations, my research seeks to reconnect a history of servant struggles over wages and conditions with broader conversations and developments in labour movement regulation and workplace rights that were happening at the beginning of the 20th century. My interest in the domestic workers' union was also prompted by Lucy Delap's assertion that domestic service should not be seen primarily as a site of victimhood, but that servants could and did enact agency in their choice of work. So, here's some photographs of some of the kind of founders and organisers of this small domestic workers' union that I've been focusing on. It was rather grandly entitled the Domestic Workers' Union of Great Britain and Ireland, and it was founded by very young women working as domestic servants in the years leading up to the First World War. So Catherine Oliver, who you see up here, worked as a cook and a general maid, and she was one of the kind of instigators of this Domestic Workers' Union in London. It was founded in the years 1909 to 1910. And in 1913, the union merged with a parallel organising project that was called the Scottish Federation of Domestic Workers that was established by Jessie Stephen, there in the middle, in Glasgow. I can't find a photograph of Grace Neal, unfortunately, but Grace Neal was a cook general who gave up her job to work full-time as the general secretary of the union in 1911 on a wage of £1 a week. And Rose Black, the third person that you see there, was the assistant secretary of that union. So the point being that these women are domestic servants themselves. Some of them continue to work as domestic servants whilst organising in the union, apart from Grace Neal, who's a full-timer on a wage of £1 a week. Women such as these had been politicised by the upsurge in working-class militancy that occurred in Britain around the turn of the 20th century.
a period marked by the formation of new unions among previously unorganised and so-called low-skilled trades, especially female-dominated sectors. The Domestic Workers' Union emerged from the grassroots as a result of domestic servants writing letters that were published in the correspondence pages of a newspaper that was called The Woman Worker. So servants wrote letters to this paper. They complained about their working conditions, and they began to demand that they would be given the same rights as other workers who they saw increasingly gaining rights in this period. So in particular, they were interested in the 10-hour day. And as a result of these letters that were written and published in the newspaper, a conversation began to emerge by domestic servants who were otherwise quite isolated and fragmented. And out of that conversation in the letters pages of The Woman Worker, the Domestic Workers' Union was founded. The Woman Worker was the organ of the National Federation of Women Workers, an umbrella group of new women's unions, and the Domestic Workers' Union was brought under the auspices of that umbrella national federation. Its organisers were also inspired by the growing and increasingly militant women's suffrage movement that's also obviously occurring at this time. So Jessie Stephen was a member of the Women's Social and Political Union. Catherine Oliver was an advocate of universal suffrage and was active in the People's Suffrage Federation. And another of the union's organisers, not photographed here, Frances Dickinson, had in fact been imprisoned for militant suffrage activity whilst also working as a servant and being involved in the union. Yet I think that we need to conceptualise the Domestic Workers' Union as emerging both in and against the women's suffrage movement and workers' movements that were happening at this time. Since although the Domestic Workers' Union made use of these existing political vocabularies to argue for recognition of their work as domestic servants, they also faced resistance from some middle-class suffragettes and suffragists, many of whom, of course, employed servants themselves, and also not so much resistance, but to a large degree, a lack of interest from some male trade unionists who believed that it was unfeasible, unrealistic to devote resources to organising a group of workers so fragmented and isolated in the homes of their employers as servants were. So perhaps this kind of lack of wholehearted support from both the women's movement and the workers' movement partly accounts for the fact that the Domestic Workers' Union remained very small. It peaked at about 2,000 members, and it was also disrupted by the outbreak of the First World War, when, of course, many women left domestic service to work in munitions factories. Although sporadic attempts were made, especially by Jessie Stephen, to reform a domestic workers' union in the interwar years. Nonetheless, I argue that this union formed a kind of tip of the iceberg. It represented the tip of the iceberg of broader and more informal organising efforts and everyday forms of resistance on the part of large numbers of domestic servants, which played at least some role in the gradual improvement in their pay and conditions that we see occurring and that Lucy has written about throughout the course of the 20th century. So here we have the objects of the union as they were first confirmed in 1910. I hope you can all read that. So these objects reflected some of the servants' most common complaints. The Domestic Workers' Union constantly reiterated that room and board, so the majority of servants in this period are live-in servants, and room and board is considered to be part of their pay. But the Domestic Servants Union has to reiterate that room and board is not bestowed due to the kindness of employers, but should be understood very clearly as part of a servant's wage. And therefore, inadequate food and uncomfortable sleeping arrangements, which so many servants complained of during this period, actually constituted a breach of contract. Within a broad commitment to improving wages and conditions, the Domestic Workers Union focused particularly on establishing definite hours of work and rest time when a servant would not be on call. So you can find, I can't see which one that is there, but you'll see an insistence on having a clearly delineated working day. The union also believed that the existing character system, whereby a servant was dependent upon an employer's reference to find a new position, needed to be radically overhauled. At present, it was felt that many mistresses withheld references or slandered their former employees simply because they were annoyed when their servant decided to leave their post. Servants were not permitted to see their references and had little legal recourse in the case of unfair treatment regarding this matter. So that's another focus for the union. Object number 13, rather obliquely entitled Help for Unfortunate Girls, refers to the union providing support for unmarried mothers among their members, and this is making a bleak reference to a kind of common workplace hazard of sexual harassment by domestic servants by their male employers, and the still common practice of firing servants who were found to be pregnant. The union remained committed to these central demands throughout its lifetime, though its objects were extended and amended over the next few years, reflecting a willingness on behalf of the union to listen to feedback and demands from its members and an everyday awareness of the realities of servants' lives. So we see some slightly sort of perhaps what we would perceive to be odd or obscure demands being added to this list. The right to use the same bathroom as employers, and the demand that no female servant be required to clean the outside of upstairs windows. But those demands give us an insight into some of the kind of, you know, daily working conditions of servants and things that they were requested to do that they found particularly oppressive. The Domestic Workers Union, founded in 1909-10, was not, as its champions in the Women Worker often claimed, the first union for domestic servants, but it did offer a new and distinctive vision of organising. Pamela Horne's History of Domestic Service records attempts in 1872 by the maid servants of Dundee and the men servants of Leamington Spa to combine in order to improve their working conditions, although these organising attempts lasted for only a very temporary period. That's in the 1870s. Pamela Horne also noted the London and Provincial Domestic Servants Union that existed between 1891 and 1893, whose committee included a number of servants from the higher end of the industry, such as butlers, cooks, and ladies' maids. Like the Domestic Workers Union, this earlier union demanded higher wages and shorter hours, yet the preface to their rule book also insisted that its aim was to educate and improve servants so that the good feelings that had existed between them and their employers of old might be re-established. This 1890s union was also opposed to strikes. The Domestic Workers Union, by contrast, had little time for such nostalgic musings on the good old faithful servant and the sentimental bond between mistress and maid. Quote, "Ladies complain that servants today are not what they were years ago," wrote Catherine Oliver. "And we rejoice to hear it," she declared. The Domestic Workers Union organisers tried their hardest to define the mistress-maid relationship as a formal contract between employer and employee, and made the case for unionisation regardless of the sympathies or otherwise of individual mistresses. Quote, "I rejoice in one of the best employers myself," Kathleen Oliver told two servants who had written to her, "but I say most emphatically that servants want a union." Scottish servants likewise wrote to the Glasgow Herald in 1913, stating that they were not interested in the condescension of a few kindly mistresses. What they wanted was, quote, "rights, not privileges." Jessie Stephen adopted a straightforward tone when discussing the role of the mistress, rejecting older tropes in which employers were alternatively sentimentalised as moral guardians or depicted as tyrants. It was no use beating about the bush any longer, said Jessie Stephen at a Glasgow maid's first public meeting. Servants simply wanted, quote, to put their position fairly and squarely before the mistresses, close quote. The Domestic Workers Union maintained that it did not represent a threat to good employers, and it called on them to lend their moral support, yet the union's view of the home as a place of employment made it necessary to recognise that mistresses and maids had competing and sometimes opposing interests. Jessie Stephen evenly stated that mistresses had their own business to look after, and no one can blame them for doing that, she said. Yet the servant likewise needed to, quote, become fully awake to her own interests. And this was entirely separate from whether the mistress and the servant got along as people or friends. This led some even progressive employers to complain that the Domestic Workers' Union was, quote, organised along class war lines, close quote. Although the union had invited sympathetic mistresses to attend its early meetings, they were also clear that, quote, we have never attempted to deny the fact that the Domestic Workers' Union is to benefit the workers. We think employers are quite able to guard their own interests. May I now very emphatically mention again that we are for the workers, close quote. Jessie Stephen likewise informed an audience of both maids and mistresses that she was out to preach the divine doctrine of discontent, and if there were any there who were content to put up with the present conditions, she asked them to leave the meeting. Such militancy was met with applause from fellow servants, and Stephen's rhetoric of class antagonism was reflected in the Glasgow Herald correspondence that about 60 domestic servants wrote into in 1913, in which many servants referred to their employers as, quote, toffs and idle gadabouts. It was this intransigent tone that distinguished the Domestic Workers' Union from other organising efforts taking place at the same time. In Scotland, the Glasgow branch of the Domestic Workers' Union came into conflict with a rival Scottish Domestic Servants' Union. This competing organisation previously confined itself to the work of a friendly society, that is, providing benefits and financial assistance to its paying members, without necessarily conceptualising itself as an organisation for workers or as a trade union as such. A representative from this rival organisation attended Jessie Stephen's, I'll flip back to our characters, Jessie Stephen's first public meeting and argued that her society was far larger than the Glasgow branch of the Domestic Workers' Union, having 5,000 members as opposed to the 60 maids who at that point had signed up to Jessie Stephen's branch. And therefore that this rival organisation should actually be in charge of organising domestic servants in Glasgow. The following evening, the Scottish Domestic Servants Union held another meeting in which they reiterated that their more established position, 15,000 members throughout Scotland, was now being claimed. And at that meeting, they determined to form themselves into a union proper, with similar demands to those agreed upon by the Domestic Workers' Union. So it's possible that some of this conflict was simply resulted from kind of internal divisions within the Scottish Labour movement. Jessie Stephen claimed that a couple of years ago she tried to attend a meeting of this rival friendly society stroke union and that she'd been barred from their meeting. But I think also there were clear political divisions and clear differences in the kind of political strategy and understanding of what it meant to be a domestic worker that we can see between these two rival organisations. The Scottish Union Secretary, Miss Elizabeth McLean, told her audience that she had attended a meeting of the Domestic Workers' Union and had been, quote, disgusted with the tone of the speaking. It seemed to be a wholesale slanging of mistresses. And this is obviously something that her organisation is against. She also reassured those present that, quote, "It was important not to disturb existing good relations between employers and employed." While Mr. J.C. McLean, treasurer of the Scottish Domestic Servants Union, said that he did not think a strike would be desirable, even in the worst straits. So a clear contrast to the rhetoric of the Domestic Workers Union. Another key difference between the Domestic Workers Union and their rivals was the former's emphasis on servants' self-organisation. The Domestic Workers Union was emphatically not a charitable association or even a top-down labour movement project concerned with the welfare of domestic workers. It wanted instead to be a grassroots union. Jesse Stephen was insistent upon the fact that the Domestic Workers Union worked entirely by servants for servants. The Domestic Workers Union was also clear that its success depended not on its leadership, but on the hard work of its members. Kathleen Oliver brusquely stated in one of her early reports that, quote, "Many of the letters sent to me have been written in a God bless you strain. I appear to be regarded almost as another messiah. This is very nice, and I appreciate it muchly, and reluctant as I am to disillusion these friends, I want to candidly tell them that if they are waiting for me to make better conditions for them, they will wait a long time. I cannot insist that servants shall not be on duty for 16 hours a day, but they can rise en masse and say it themselves."
Now, for the last 10 minutes or so, is open up, right, so obviously this has been a very focused discussion of a particular small domestic workers' union. I'm going to try and open some of these issues up now to talk a little bit about what I'm trying to do in the book that I'm writing at the moment, which is about the relationship between feminism, particularly the suffrage movement in early 20th century Britain, and something that was known as the servant problem. A perceived and extremely widely commented upon problem or shortage of reliable and competent domestic servants that many, many people wrote about in this period. And of course, the women's suffrage movement was also as kind of preoccupied with this question of the servant problem as anybody else in this period. I'm just trying to work out whether I should do this on the thing that I wrote. Right. I'm going to try and ad-lib this a bit because I think it's a bit clearer. Okay, so this servant problem that everybody was talking about in the late 19th and early 20th century has often, you know, kind of been wryly dismissed or passed over by historians as a kind of sort of trivial middle-class gripe. Oh dear, we can't get the staff nowadays, ha ha. I want to suggest that actually the servant problem indicates a much more kind of profound shift that is occurring in late 19th and early 20th century British society at this time, and that it's kind of indicative of quite a deep social anxieties about rising worker militancy, the changing role of women and a strengthening feminist movement, and the reconfiguration of the relationship between home and work that these things entailed. So, firstly, I've said that the servant problem needs to be seen, and was indeed seen at the time, actually, as in part a problem of rising worker militancy. Domestic servants, so the Domestic Workers Union is probably the most explicitly articulated example of that rising militancy among domestic servants, but it's certainly not the only example. Lucy has written about, an unwillingness of young working class women to enter domestic servant, which is something that is noted from the kind of late 19th century onwards. And that those women who did enter domestic service often changed their jobs very frequently, moved from post to post, took advantage of a kind of, of a perceived shortage of servants to be able to demand better wages and conditions or to change posts when they were unhappy in them. So partly this servant problem is a problem of militancy among young working class women and domestic servants. Secondly, I want to suggest that we should understand this servant problem as indicative of what today we would call a crisis of care. And I think Karen is going to talk about that kind of contemporary versions of a crisis of care in a minute. I want to suggest that the servant problem really did reflect a real shortage of willing reproductive labourers. So we need to understand the servant problem as occurring in a context whereby increasingly large numbers of middle-class women are now undertaking waged work in the public sphere as opposed to being full-time housewives or mistresses in their home. So I've got written that down more clearly somewhere. And this is, this is a hypothesis, so I'm interested in what people think about whether this works or not. But we do know that the number of middle-class women engaged in waged work rose significantly between 1860 and 1914, partly due to their entry into the previously male-dominated professions, but especially because of the vast expansion of white blouse occupations such as teaching, nursing, shop work, clerical work, and the civil service that occurred at this time. I've lost my page, next page. And so this entry of middle-class women into the labour market was, of course, in part the result of campaigns by the women's movement for improved education and employment opportunities that had been growing since the sort of 1860s onwards. So not only does this reduce the number of middle-class women with full-time responsibility for at least managing and indeed doing part of domestic labour, it also increased the demand for domestic servants to cater for the domestic needs of this new group of single and sometimes married professional women. So, therefore, I want to suggest that the so-called servant problem is not just about perceptions of a shortage of willing domestic servants, but it is actually a kind of comment upon a sort of crisis of care, a reduction in the number of willing reproductive labourers. The women's movement talks about all of these issues a lot. The servant problem, the problem of the professional woman, the problem of the single working lady, and indeed it also talks about the problem of poor wages and conditions for domestic servants themselves. But it never really finds a resolution. And the reason it doesn't find a resolution is because very few people in that women's movement are willing to say that they themselves want to take on what was frequently referred to as the drudge work of cooking and cleaning. Childcare is discussed in a slightly different way. Childcare is seen in many ways as creative work that can kind of be recuperated as potentially a professional activity. Cooking and cleaning is almost invariably discussed as drudge work. And although there are currents within the women's suffrage movement that certainly do seek to politicise the home, that seek to revalue the work of women done in the domestic sphere, that seek to use women's direct domestic role and responsibilities as the basis upon which to argue for an expanded role in the polity, for more rights in the political and the public sphere, very few are actually willing to embrace the drudge work of cooking and cleaning over supposedly more creative forms of work, more valuable forms of work, more kind of worthwhile forms of work. And of course, at the same time as seeking to politicise the position of women in the home, the women's movement from the 1860s onwards is very firmly wed to a vision of emancipation secured through waged and particularly professional work in the public sphere. So what does domestic service or domestic labour mean within that vision of emancipation through professional work? It's very difficult for the women's movement to sort of be able to reconcile the drudge work of kitchen work and domestic servants with their vision of ennobling and valuable work for women. And of course, this unresolved question of domestic labour and who would do it is also unresolved because of the question of class conflict that exists between domestic servants and their female employers, between suffragist and suffragette mistresses, and suffragist and suffragette maids, of which there were a number. And so, of course, the suffrage movement is very much a movement that seeks to unite women of all classes around a common cause, the fight for the vote, and it is therefore unable to kind of process and think about the conflict of interests that exists very, very directly in the homes of suffrage activists themselves between mistress and maid. Another bit of my book is about the kind of fights that occur actually in the pages of The Women Worker, the newspaper I mentioned before, and other suffrage publications, between these militant servants talking about forming a union, complaining about their condition, and progressive suffrage-supporting mistresses who say, what are you complaining about? You've got it easy compared to me, who's trying to balance family life with professional life or political activism with my domestic responsibilities. So I would suggest that this question of reproductive labour and who is going to do it is never really resolved, at least in the early 20th century British feminist movement. And I'm interested to now hear what Karen thinks about the kind of legacies of that in thinking about these issues today.
I'm very pleased to be responding to Laura's paper today, which I think is a great piece of labour history that has very high relevance for unionists. I actually want to encourage more academic historians who want to make a difference to consider producing educational material that is aimed at trade union activists and leaders. I say this because unions tend to have rather short institutional memories rather than historical memories. And too often, we like to reinvent the wheel. So we like to say we do things for the first time, even if it's been done 100 years ago. So unionists can really benefit from understanding historical continuities and parallels to better inform what we do. The research Laura has presented certainly made me reflect on the challenges we face in new ways. And I want to explore some of this and hopefully prompt a good discussion among you today. I want to do two things in 15 minutes. I want to draw out some of the themes and conclusions and observations from Laura's paper that help us position some of the current union struggles. And I want to also give a brief overview of the situation facing domestic workers in Europe. I will focus on the situation in Europe as a whole, and this is generalising because the situation is so different across Western, Eastern, Southern Europe and between countries. But at the same time, looking at Europe as a whole in this way makes sense because it relates to the active policy making that is happening at the EU level at the moment. I want to start by talking about the demographic situation, which I think is absolutely essential to understanding the changing nature of work in domestic occupations. Across Europe, we are witnessing an unprecedented demographic shift. We often hear about it as an ageing population crisis or even as an ageing time bomb. We have to remember that there are two sides to this so-called crisis. It's not just that there are more old people. Because we're not having as many children as our parents, we're also seeing the working age population undergoing a numerical decline. So there's a general labour squeeze going on. There are fewer people available to work and even fewer to provide care to others, while the number of people who need care is rising year by year. We're quite frankly locked into this dynamic, into the future. Europe will need to keep importing workers as a way to deal with the situation, and that is indeed what is happening today, Fortress Europe notwithstanding. The point I want to make is that care workers are at a pointy end to this broader labour contraction. In 2010, the European Commission warned that there would be a shortage of 1 million workers by 2020 unless countermeasures were taken in response. Spend money on long-term care, the EU Commission warned states in 2010. It was very simple. Now, it might come as no surprise to you that, in fact, the very opposite happened. Austerity Europe largely ignored the warning. Here in the UK, the government actively undermines and cuts back funding to the care sector with disastrous and predictable consequences. In the rest of Europe, it is maybe not as bad, yet investment in care home infrastructure and funding lags far behind demand. Governments have relied largely on private investors, pension funds and the like, to invest billions into building new care homes, rather than financing it through state revenues. This has given rise to a lucrative long-term care sector, with large and very profitable multinational care home operators merging and consolidating their position across Europe. At the same time, many ordinary people are increasingly being priced out of the formal care system, particularly in countries in southern Europe where the care system was never properly developed in the first place. Increasingly, people are being pushed into private models of care, while at the same time, care in the home is what many elderly people are expressing a clear preference for. Understandably, people want to live out the last years of their life at home rather than in a soulless institution. So the situation of an ongoing demographic shift, combined with the politics of austerity and underinvestment, has resulted in a shift of care into the home and a boom in both formal and informal employment of care workers in private residences. These dynamics are resulting in an acute labour shortage, a real crunch for care work. It is a situation that is considered unprecedented by many, and yet Laura's research reveals a very powerful historical analogy, and I think that is an important point to bear in mind. Many of the workers employed in private homes are now undertaking care occupations. Many have qualifications and experience and training, and yet they are treated as domestic servants by their employers, by families and clients, by labour laws and by society as a whole. They are often described as invisible workers and still considered by many unionists to be unorganisable because of their atomised and fragmented workplaces. It's the very same attitude held by some male unionists 100 years ago that we heard from Laura. What I'm arguing, I guess, by talking about this is that I think that there is an argument to be made for changing class dimensions of the modern domestic service workforce. And I think there are two aspects to this. There's a proletarianization of sorts of the recipients of domestic servants. No longer rich people, but aged and disabled, many of whom are in fact priced out of the more formal, more expensive end. At the same time, there's an upskilling of the workforce of a sort, less of a focus on miscellaneous servants and more on professional care provision. Care work is, of course, still performed by women. Increasingly, however, it is migrant women, including those who face insecure migration status and are pushed into the informal economy. We can see why live-in care work is attractive for undocumented migrants, but also how it can easily become a type of semi-slavery, where workers are trapped in exploitative employment relationships by a lack of civil and migration rights that others have access to. This is not to say that all migrant workers are undocumented, far from it. Most are EU migrants with freedom to move. Yet employment of undocumented migrants in private homes has particularly come to define the care systems in southern Europe, countries like Italy and Spain. So where do all these migrant care workers come from? As you can see, from just about everywhere. The critical thing here is that these flows are not simple. Migration flows are a system with movements both within Europe and into Europe. Feminist economists have a term for this complication of international flows in care labour. They call them global care chains, and this is the phenomenon we are witnessing here. This map is from 2012. I wish I had a more recent map to show you, because today there should be a big arrow pointing from Poland, from Ukraine to Poland. Due to the civil war, there's today more Ukrainian migrants in Poland than Poles in the UK. Many work in the informal or semi-formal economy, especially in agriculture and in care. Many Ukrainian women work in private homes to fill the extreme care shortages in Poland, which are the consequence of so many Polish care workers migrating to countries like the UK, Germany, Ireland, Italy, and Switzerland to find work. So the migrants from poorer Eastern European countries, especially Ukraine, come in to fill that gap. And that, in a nutshell, is how global care chains work. I want to now take you to Poland briefly, and then I want to take you to Switzerland. This is my babcia. I'm Polish by birth, and my grandmother is in a care home in Wrocław. I'm going to go visit her soon. She's been receiving care for 15 years now. She's had 4 strokes, and each time she needed higher level of care. Today she is 100% dependent. She's lucky to have a place in a high quality facility because there isn't a huge shortage of institutional care places in Poland. Before babcia had her latest stroke, she was cared for at home. She received care from a wonderful woman called Pani Ella, a professional carer who my family found when babcia first got sick. This situation lasted for about 10 years. Pani Ella eventually retired from her work, from her formal job as a care worker, but kept working informally as a carer, looking after my grandmother for a few days a week. Now that my grandmother is in a care facility, Pani Ella still visits her twice a week, which means my gran is doubly lucky. Pani Ella has saved my babcia's life on several occasions, but she is herself getting old and will soon need care for herself. I'm telling this story because there are hundreds of thousands of women just like Pani Ella who are skilled, experienced, and nearing retirement age. These women leave Poland to care for elderly and disabled people in Western European countries, and they do so out of economic necessity to support their families back home. One popular destination for them is Switzerland. It's a rich country with a wealthy, aging middle class, big care shortages, and the highest wages in Europe. Care workers travel from Poland to Switzerland. They are often recruited through employment agencies, and they go there to live and work in the homes of their clients. Effectively, they are on shift for periods of 1 to 3 months, working 24 hours in these homes and then returning to their families after a few months. A few years ago, these workers said they had had enough of exploitation by agencies, of being paid six hours pay for 24 hours of work. They were sick of their vague contracts, the culture of fear and lack of job security, the isolation of working non-stop in someone's home with a lack of break times, and they felt humiliated by additional domestic service responsibilities given to them by the families of clients. In the city of Basel, Polish women met each other in the local Polish church. They formed the Respect Network, which became their support network. They organized their own unions to make sure that Swiss labor laws applied to them. They demanded that they be respected like any other workers. These workers got organized, successfully sued employers for back pay. They agitated against the system that leaves them 50% worse than Swiss workers, and they went on strike. There is a lot more I can say about this, but I'll leave that for the discussion. I want to put an emphasis on Laura's point that just like 100 years ago, domestic workers are self-organizing and they are winning, despite the supposed unfeasibility of unions to organize them. I wanted to quickly wrap up by returning to the big policy picture. The care sector is growing. It is a booming sector of the economy, and the crisis in care is very real. And thankfully, we are now seeing some change at top European level. It is being discussed at peak levels by European policymakers, and unions are leading in this space. Last year, UniGlobal held a political event at the EU Parliament in Brussels, where we engaged EU decision makers and politicians, and they got to hear some of these feisty Polish women telling them like it is. These photos here, there's two women speaking, Beata and Alina, who's there in the middle. They're leaders there who led some of these efforts of Polish workers in Switzerland. And they're here at the ESC, the European Economic and Social Committee, talking about the rights of living care workers. We followed up this successful intervention with this opinion in the European Economic and Social Committee, which was represents a consensus position of about 300 peak union, NGO, and employer associations of Europe. So we put forward some strong recommendations for what should be done at the EU level to ensure labour rights for living work for living care workers. And this opinion was successfully adopted at the official position of the ESC. In terms of how we argued this, we positioned the argument in relation to existing policy positions that are already pretty much held by civil society in Europe, while demonstrating the need to specifically address the live-in care workforce. The key arguments we pushed was that live-in care work has been largely overlooked and excluded from the care system planning, despite these workers holding such a critical position and role in meeting the rising demands for care in the future. We affirm the EEC's stance of support for the ILO 189 Convention on Domestic Work, which is a very big campaign at the moment all across Europe to try to actually win certain basic labour law parallels to labour law for domestic workers who are often excluded from the laws in their countries. But that is changing. There's now, I think, 8 or 9 countries in Europe that have signed the convention. And most importantly of all, I think, we called for the regularisation of undocumented migrant workers. So actually, the argument is being put very strongly that when you employ people, you know, so-called illegal workers, and these people are looking after people's grandmothers, and they are being excluded from all labour rights, being excluded from civil rights, and they don't have a secure migration status. That is actually a condition of slavery, and that something needs to be done. And the best thing that can be done is to give these workers a right to work and to stay in the country, performing what is actually crucial labour that Europe as a whole requires in order to be a working society into the future. So I might just end it there. If people want to read any of this policy work, I've put a couple of links up here. And I've got a hard copy of the What is the Future of Care report, if people would like to have a look, and also the opinion, but I only have these two copies, so there's two links there. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you. That was great. Thanks very much, Lucy, for organising this exemplary session with history and policy coming together. Because it's a particular interest of mine, I mean, I learned a lot from both papers, I should say. I was wondering about a connection between the last thing that Karol said about regularisation of undocumented migrant workers and one of the 10 claims in the domestic workers union list that you put up, which we didn't actually talk about. There were many other things to talk about, which was the intriguing one about a free registry office, which they asked for. And I'm just wondering, I mean, is that in fact more or less the same thing that is being talked about in each case? In other words, if workers are undocumented in some sense, then they're very easy to exploit in all kinds of ways. And so the kind of the number, one can talk about rights in philosophy and rhetoric and so on, but when it comes down to practicalities, it's a rather mundane issue about, apparently mundane issue, about registration and authoritative lists being maintained and so on, that is crucial. And until you kind of get that step, you're really only talking, you're not actually delivering, you know, real policy that can have bite to it and where people can end up contesting things in courts on the basis of legal documentation and so on. And if that's true, what was the history of that claim in the past? Did it go anywhere back in 1909-10? And if so, where did it go? What's going on right now in the present on this issue, if you both agree that it is kind of quite fundamental, really?
Do you want to give us some history?
The Free Registry Office is not about migration. It's about, it's like an agent, it's about agent, it's a servant's agency, I guess, mm-hmm. Yeah. So it does have some resonances with the present day, although not specifically around the question of migration. So the Domestic Workers Union wanted to set up its own servants agency where people, employers would come and find a servant and servants would come and find an employer, because they felt that a lot of agencies were working in the interests of employers and allowing bad characters, these references, to be written about servants without them being checked. What they also did is they set up a blacklist of bad employers, because they said already there's a blacklist of bad servants being circulated and agencies are complicit in this blacklisting of servants because someone's complained about them. So we're going to do the opposite. We're going to have a blacklist of bad and unjust and exploitative employers. I mean, it is an example of... I mean, Carolyn Steedman, in her work on the 18th century, wants to emphasise the degree to which servants did have legal rights and did use the law and were not these completely... completely hyper-exploited people who had no capacity to take their rights to the law and assert their voice within that system. And obviously changes do occur between the 18th century and the late 19th century and early 20th century. But, nevertheless, the existence of rights in abstract don't necessarily mean rights on the ground. So I guess in that sense, this union-run registry was a way to try and make those rights real rather than just formal in some ways.
And did they get anywhere with it?
I haven't actually been able to find out any information about that registry. This union only lasts in that particular form for a very short period of time, for about 4 years before the outbreak of war, and then it kind of re-emerges in these very sporadic ways afterwards. I don't think they did get anywhere with organising their own registries. I think in the United States that was a much clearer strategy, particularly by African American domestic workers in the 1930s organising their own registries, but not one that I've been able to find in Britain.
I'm not really sure how registries currently... I mean, there's a few... things to say about overall in terms of migrant rights and how, I guess, labour law and trying to help workers who are in marginalised positions in terms of their migration status, if they try to assert their rights and what happens next. There's a big argument being made among migrant rights advocates for, well, regularisation. And, lifting of the illegal status of workers. But as a sort of intermediate step towards that, setting up firewalls between the police and labour inspectorates, so that basically you don't end up in a situation where someone says, I'm being enslaved by my employer. Okay, there's going to be sanctions, etc. Oh, you're illegal. Get out of the country. Because that is actually what drives the process of enslavement. So it's a very reasonable argument being made to the bureaucracy in a way. You should separate your functions. And so I'm not sure if that answers your question, but it is kind of, I guess, how... The vast bulk of this sector is informal, and people don't have a clue as to how big it is. They're not measured. There's no real data collection. Live-in care workers are lumped together with domestic servants in terms of how this data is collected by agencies like Eurostat, so top data collection in Europe. It's, and then it varies country by country. There's no consistency in terms of... Our actual evidence is very poor. And one of the things we're saying is you can't just treat this group of workers as some undifferentiated, massive, unqualified, invisible labour, because they're not invisible, they're going on strike. So I guess it's part of that sort of discourse where we're taking that. Yeah. I'm not sure if that answers the registry question
I understand it provokes very difficult issues, yeah.
I'm trying to get a sense for, so we've got 1860 to 1914, more middle-class women taking up employment, creating more demand for domestic service. Is Do we have any data across sort of female participation in different sectors? So are these women coming out of other sectors, or is this a less attractive, or are there other sectors pulling or pushing women into this?
Are you talking about domestic service?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm not an economic historian, so I need some help kind of, you know, checking that I'm understanding this these kind of census figures correctly. But, right, the number of women in wage work between 1850 and 1911 actually declines at a certain point and then slightly goes up by 1911. So the point is that it's not more women per se in wage work, it's more middle class women
right.
in wage work. So the number of women in what we would see as white blouse professions or professional work does go up quite a lot. Arguably, the number of working class women in wage work goes down because we can think about protective legislation in factories. But what I'm suggesting is there's fewer middle class women with full time responsibility for managing the home, and there is also not a decline in the numbers of domestic servants, but an expansion of other kinds of working class jobs. So there is a pull factor as well for working for women who might have been working in service
yes.
who are not. Does that make sense?
That was my question.
Shop work like manufacturing. Yeah.
I wanted to ask a follow up question about this Simon's point about registration and so on, and the pressures on the domestic service and care sectors around migration. And this really, in a way, is a question to Laura about the sort of next phase of domestic worker unions. And this may move out of your comfort zone, but I'm thinking here of the 1938 Domestic Workers Union, which was set up, curiously, it's the one union that's set up in this way by the Trade Union Congress. Mm-hmm. They said, you know, we're going to found a union here. It's not a grassroots initiative that we are then absorbing. We're actually going to set this up. And the reason why they see an opportunity to set it up is because there's enormous discontent in the domestic service sector with the growing competition of workers who are coming in from, who have been displaced by events happening in the continent. So they're mainly coming from Austria and Germany. So it's got kind of feet of clay in a way, this union. It's coming from a place which is responding to kind of the labour competition. And so in a way, Karol's emphasis is on, you know, these are migrant workers and they need to be registered and given rights. Your emphasis is on the fabulous activism of these early 20th century unions and their agency and their refusal of the sort of appropriate scripts that working class women are meant to follow. But it comes together in the 1930s with a group of fabulous, vocal, articulate working class women who are saying, let's keep out these
yeah.
Jewish workers,
mm-hmm.
These refugees, these continental figures. How do we square all this up?
Well, I mean,
this is all new to me. I don't know this episode of labour history, so it's fascinating. I mean, I think just like any workers, any unions, I mean, there's always contradictions, and you know,
mm-hmm.
and
yeah.
for me, there's a big. I hesitate to call it a problem because I don't see it as much, but I see it as a big tension between the EU and non-EU parts of
mm-hmm.
this workforce,
mm-hmm.
Because both operate in the same labour market and both are sort of, you know, but one group of workers has rights to move and the other one doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
So that immediately changes, I guess, some of the power and in terms of who might have the capacity to organise and who might be able to be, you know, confident. These women in Switzerland are confident in the sense that they are able to, you know, to, and they have institutions around them like the Polish church, for instance.
Mm-hmm.
So even though they work 24/7, they get a little bit of time off to attend church on Sunday. So that's where they meet and that's where they organise.